Good morning, and welcome to everyone on this first official day of fall. We are so glad you are with us, whether you're here in person, as a guest, a friend, or joining us online. If you are new here, if you would feel comfortable doing this, please fill out this card that is in the front of your pew and leave it in the offering plate before you leave. We'd be happy to receive that. The flowers this morning on the altar are given to the glory of God in loving memory of B. Walker. So today, September 22nd, is also Treaty 7 Day. So Treaty 7 is the last of the numbered treaties made between the Government of Canada and the Plains First Nations, signed in 1877. There is a land acknowledgement in the bulletin. I'm going to digress from that a little bit and read one that is one of my favorites. And it's thanks to Jake who provided this several years ago. So it is in a spirit of respect and truth that we acknowledge that we live, work, and play where the Elbow and Bow Rivers meet and the mountains take on different hues in the light of the sun. We acknowledge that each part of the land that make up the Treaty 7 area of Southern Alberta has a name and a story. These names and stories are meant to orient us to the sacred space that have been the ancestral homelands and healing place for the Siksika, Kainai, and Piikani peoples who make up the Blackfoot Confederacy, the Tsuut'ina people and the Bearspaw, Shinnecke, and Wesley peoples who are Stony Nakoda, and the peoples of Métis Region 3. This land is a place of belonging. The mountains, plains, and rivers tell the stories of time before memory can recall. This is a place where the trees and the winds carry stories and spirit and song, whose medicines have understood that the Creator is good and invites us to live in harmony. We acknowledge that we are in continual communion with the land and the peoples who make their homes here. We are invited to be faithful servants and constant stewards alongside our neighbors and lend our hands to bringing about balance and wholeness for all who call this place home. May we have ears to hear and hearts to listen and live in the gifts, care, and stories that the land offers, working together to honor, respect, and listen to each other, so all would know and share the good that is offered. So the bulletin is just full of great, good information, and I really encourage you to read it thoroughly from start to finish. But I do want to highlight a couple things. First of all, the Sunday school, church school, will be doing a fire drill this morning. And we are asking all parents to please meet their children in the muster point out the south door there after worship. You don't have to run out during worship to do that. So after worship, please meet your children outside there. There is an evening service tonight at 7 o'clock in the chapel. The entrance is through the north door, which is that way. And this is the first time in a long time that we've come together as an evening service. And there will be refreshments after, so please join us and pass the word. Next Sunday will be Orange Shirt Sunday. We encourage you to wear orange if you can. We have special activities planned for the church school, we look forward to seeing everybody then. There will be much acknowledgement next Sunday for this. Volunteer Appreciation Lunch, October the 6th. We hope that you will all come. And Matt has asked me to remind everyone that there is a cello that Matt is organizing this cello piano concert Sunday afternoon, next Sunday afternoon, September 29th at 2 p.m. Details are in the bulletin. I encourage you to look at Grace at a Glance. You'll be able to see exactly what's going on in the month of October, and you'll be able to pick and choose what you would like to do during October. There's lots of options. So, one other thing. The directory is here. There it is. We have copies for all of those who were involved in getting their photographs taken and new members and so on. They will be available in the alcove after worship. So please go and pick yours up and sign off that you have received yours. They've done a beautiful job. I had a peek look earlier, and it is really well done. So congratulations to everyone who is involved in that process. I think that is all for this morning. And I'll ask Ainsley to come up and light the Christ candle.
Friends, let's draw our hearts to God's heart by sharing the words of our responsive call to worship found in the bulletin. Please join your voice with mine in the text that is in bold. From sunrise to sunset, let us praise God's holy name. Draw near to the God of life. We will worship God now and always. Please join your voice with mine as we raise our voices in song, singing the words of hymn number 738, God the Omnipotent, in the Book of Praise, or it's found on the screen for those of you joining online. Let's sing together. Thank you. Our worship continues in prayers of adoration and a rite of reconciliation. So let us pray. Almighty God, you created the heavens and the earth and made humankind in your image. Teach us to discern your hand in all your works and to follow your ways with reverence and thanksgiving. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated. Hear this invitation inviting us into a time of reconciliation. The wisdom that comes from above is peaceable, gentle, and full of mercy and good fruits. Because we trust in God to give us these good gifts, we are bold to pray, telling the truth about ourselves and the world, confident in God's mercy. So let us pray together. God of all creation, you created the world around us and filled it with wonder. Yet we confess we look away from its harsher realities. Our ears can be deaf to the cries of need. Our minds ignore opinions which differ from our own. Cleanse us from envy and selfish ambition. Forgive us when we seek greatness instead of goodness and miss the wisdom you intend us to embrace. Set us on the path that leads to life, to the glory of Christ. Friends, hear this good news. Christ meets our confession with his grace. It is God's grace that invites our truth-telling, and it is God's grace that cleanses us and sets us free. In the name of Christ, we are all forgiven. Thanks be to God. May the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you. Let us reflect on the peace that Christ gives as we take in the anthem based on Psalm 1 that is composed by Mark Hayes.
And all it will shall thrive. It's time to invite the children to come and join me here at the front. I think we will gather over here on this side. How's everybody doing today? Okay? Yeah? I've asked a couple of people how school is going. Those of you who are in school, everybody says it's just fantastic. Everybody's been really loving, and I hope the same is true for you too. Such a beautiful day to worship here today. I think all of our friends are with us, and so I wanted to remind you that this month we've been talking about a little book in the Bible, actually it was a letter called James. And James was a letter that was written to a church that is a church like we're a church, a group of people who come together to worship God, who believe in Jesus Christ. That's who we are. We're a church like that. And this church was the same way. They came together and they believed in Jesus and they worshiped together. And this church was just like our church in that it had a lot of different kinds of people in it. It had people in it who had all kinds of different skin colors. It had people in it who were all different ages. It had people in it who were from all kinds of different places. It had people in it who, when they were out in their work in the world, they all had different jobs. And sometimes they believed lots of different things. But they all came together because they believed in Christ. Now, sometimes there were all kinds of different people there, and they had different amounts of money and things. It sounds very much like us, our church here today. We have all different kinds of people here in this place, all different skin colors, all different from different places in the world, all of us coming together into this place for one reason, because we love Jesus and we want to follow him. Sometimes when all kinds of different people get together, they don't get along. Now, I know this is probably not true for all of you, but it can be true, and maybe it is sometimes true for you too. Sometimes because we are different from each other, we don't always get along with each other. And that's true out in the world too. We see lots and lots of people out in the world right now who don't get along and who are fighting in all different parts of the world, and it's so sad to see it and hear about it. And that can sometimes happen in the church too. And James is writing to that group and saying to them, reminding them, hey, you know what? We are all here for the same reason. We love Jesus. And it doesn't matter how different we look. It doesn't matter how much or how little we have. We are all here together. And God calls us to live together in peace. And that's an important word. That's the word of the day for today. James wants us to live together in peace, which means that even if we don't always see the things the same way, we still love each other and we still come together and we are gentle with each other and kind with each other and we listen to each other. And you know what's really important to me, at least, is that the world outside these doors can look at us here in the church and say, you know, if they can get along like that, if they can be a peaceful community, as different as they are, then maybe it's possible for us too. And maybe that's one way there would be less fighting in the world and more peace. So I want you to think about that today. Think about our friend James. And think about our church, our beautiful church here that's gathered together, and how he calls us to live together in peace. So let's pray now. And if you would join with me, and we'll invite everyone to join us. Dear Jesus, help me to be peaceful. Help me to be kind. And help me to follow you every day. Amen. Okay, today we are going to ask Micah and Kavya and Tejas to take the candles, and you may now go with them to church school.
Let us pray. Shine the light of your word on the path ahead, O God. Help us choose the way of your wisdom so we may bear fruit that is pleasing to you and shines your light into the world around us. Amen. Blessed are those who do not follow the advice of the wicked, or take the path that sinners tread, or sit in the seat of scoffers. They are like trees planted by streams of water, which yield their fruit in season, and their leaves do not wither. Who is wise and understanding among you? Show by your good life that your works are done with gentleness, born of wisdom. But if you have bitter envy and selfish ambition in your hearts, do not be boastful and false to the truth. Such wisdom does not come down from above, but is earthly, unspiritual, devilish. For where there is envy and selfish ambition, there is also disorder and wickedness of every kind. But the wisdom from above is first pure, then peaceable, gentle, willing to yield, full of mercy and good fruits, without a trace of partiality or hypocrisy. And a harvest of righteousness is sown in peace for those who make peace. Those conflicts and disputes among you, where do they come from? Do they not come from your cravings that are at war within you? You want something and do not have it, so you commit murder. And you covet something and cannot obtain it, so you engage in disputes and conflicts. You do not have because you do not ask. You ask and do not receive because you ask wrongly in order to spend what you get on your pleasures.
The question is as fresh as this week. You've all Noah Hariri, the author of the mega best-selling book Sapiens, has a book just out now called Nexus, a brief history of information networks from the Stone Age to AI. In a book review, the reviewer quotes Hariri, saying he asks a poignant question that, for now, I think, I hope, can only be addressed by humans. Why are we so good at accumulating more information and power, but far less successful at acquiring wisdom? If you like, you can go back about 500 years to hear it put this way. The first sentence in John Calvin's monumental Institutes of the Christian Religion, arguably the words that form the essence of the Reformed and Presbyterian faith, the very first sentence reads thus: Our wisdom, insofar as it ought to be deemed true and solid wisdom, consists almost entirely of two parts: the knowledge of God and of ourselves. And somewhere, if you listen closely, you can hear an unlikely amen emanating 1,500 years prior to that from our friend James. We've come full circle in our little letter, back to the theme that hums under the surface of the whole book, a theme that itself has a long through line in Judaism, stretching back to King Solomon and the books of Proverbs and Ecclesiastes and some of the Psalms. Wisdom. Wisdom. And James has a warning for those in his congregation who think themselves wise. Wisdom, he says, is not to be found solely or even primarily in the brain or in the intellect. Now, you know that the first century church was surrounded by Greek philosophical movements grounded in the intellect. Just one example, Plutarch, a Greek philosopher who lived and worked about 100 years before Christ. He is best known for a thought experiment, maybe some of you know it, called the Ship of Theseus. He asked the question, if a ship's planks are all replaced, is it the same ship? I'll give you a moment. It's fascinating to think about. It's like my philosophy professor who once said to us, this table is not really there. It's not really a table. You just imagine it to be a table. It's an idea of a table in your head. And I nodded as if I understood what he was saying and said, fascinating, fascinating. But is it wise, these kinds of questions? Do they produce wisdom? James announces a different understanding of wisdom. A life of gentleness is a surer sign of wisdom than a high IQ. James seems to say. And bitter envy and selfish ambition do not reflect the wisdom that comes from above, but foolishness that comes from below, he says. Wisdom is pure and peaceable and willing to yield and full of mercy. These are the marks of wisdom. This is the good fruit that comes from above. These themes are clear. They've been with us throughout the book of James. The life of a follower of Jesus Christ takes on a certain shape. It grows identifiable fruit. It yields a harvest. And this is true wisdom, not what you think, but what you do. It's the image of a harvest that marks the center of this small letter, around which all the other themes and images turn. A harvest of righteousness, he calls it, which, as you know, can be translated justice. A harvest of justice is sown in peace for those who make peace. And here's where we can begin to detect the beating heart of this letter. The call to peace and to peacemaking, the call echoed in the very words of Christ, blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called children of God, for they shall inherit the earth. Many scholars believe that James was addressing new converts, as you heard me mention or allude to briefly with the children, coming into the fold who are bringing with them the values of the world around them. Significant discrimination based on wealth was one of those. The endorsement of violence to achieve political and economic ends, that was another one. A lack of civility in dealing with fellow church members, and on and on and on it went. In response to this crisis, James has been moving ever so diligently toward this still point, ever since the first chapter, this harvest of peace. Annalena Baerbock, the German Minister of Foreign Affairs, said this week that the entire region of the Middle East is, quote, once again holding its breath. Dr. Dania El Halak works in an emergency room in Beirut, in Lebanon. After pagers and other devices exploded across Lebanon, she had little time to process all she was seeing coming into her hospital, horrific scenes. And she said, quote, "I'm hoping that it was all just a bad dream." Holding a collective breath, hoping against hope. I heard someone say not too many weeks ago to me, a Christian minister, that any Christian minister who talks about the tens of thousands of Palestinians killed in the war in Gaza, but also mentions the events of October 7th, 2023, when Hamas attacked Israel, was engaging in both sidesism. That any minister, in other words, looking at me again, who tries to understand the conflict from all the perspectives at play, was not preaching the gospel. I heard from Neil Blumhoff, a Jewish rabbi in Austin, Texas, and a friend who wrote about the recent protests on the University of Texas campus and how the students, he said, were not engaged in any kind of dialogue, but were only interested in shouting down any opposition. He said, quote, "Without engagement, without a desire to learn and empathize with another's story, then all of this becomes empty sloganeering." And then he quoted a Gazan, Ahmed Fawud Al-Khatib, a man from Gaza who has lost 31 family members in this war to date, who said, "Working towards a just and equitable resolution of the injustices facing the Palestinian people should include Israelis, must include Israelis. They are a part of the solution." One of my good friends the other day said he was told by someone else that anyone who speaks out against the war in Gaza and Lebanon and criticizes Israel's actions is engaging in anti-Semitism. And he said to me, "It just makes me want to say nothing at all. The whole thing seems set up to make you either Islamophobic or anti-Semitic." And yet, are there not Gazans and Lebanese who are calling for peace and for a relationship with Israel that recognizes its right to exist? And are there not thousands of Israelis who are joining in these calls, looking for peaceful solutions, making common cause with brothers and sisters across the aisle, so to speak? Does that not at least give us pause? Those of us who can sometimes be just so sure of ourselves that it's black and white. I bring all this up, this melange of incidents and comments, not because I think I have a solution. If you were thinking that's where this was going, you can go ahead and go to the muster point if you would like. I bring it up to show that the things James confronts in the church in the first century continue to emerge in the 21st century. The same ease with which we can draw up sides and justify violence or intolerance and simplifications that make the other, whoever the other is, expendable, are all still with us. Haven't gone away. Many of you sitting in this room have come from places where that violence is so very real right this moment. James confronts three groups of people in the church. It's just a small church. This is such a small letter. Three groups. One group wants what they do not have, and they're ready to commit violence to get it. The desire for the accumulation of things has overridden their care and concern for human life, and the result is bloodshed. No doubt there were people in the church who were affected by this violence, perhaps perpetrators of this violence. It was always close at hand. Another group covets what others have inside the church, and this covetousness has created tension and division in the life of the congregation. We've already heard elsewhere in James that he is concerned with the stark divide between rich and poor in the wider society, and the ways that divide has found its way into the life of the church. Remember from a couple of weeks ago his example of a wealthy person coming into the church and being fawned over and given the best seats in the house while the poor are not regarded. This is the phenomenon that he continues to write about. But the third group is the spiritual group, who are not committing violence to get what they want and not coveting what others have, but are simply asking God to give them what they want. Fred Craddock paraphrases it nicely. You're not going to get it because it's not what you need, it's what you desire. It's hedonistic pleasure seeking. You are asking wrongly. I recall a Sunday evening service at a church in Nashville some 30 years ago where a woman stood up to ask for prayer. She was concerned that a proposed new landfill in the city was going to be built in her neighborhood. She asked us to join in her prayer that it would not be built there. What she didn't mention was that the current landfill was in a predominantly African-American neighborhood called Bordeaux, where it had been for over 30 years. And the only two options on the table for the city were to move it to the prayer-requesting person's neighborhood or to leave it in Bordeaux. So she was asking us to pray, in essence, that God would favor her over the residents of Bordeaux. And I understand the dilemma, don't we all? None of us would probably want that landfill in our neighborhood. But I can hear James saying to her and to all of us that were in that sanctuary that night, you ask wrongly. You ask wrongly. Why are we so good at accumulating more information and power, but far less successful at acquiring wisdom? Well, James has an answer to that. And typical of James, it is infuriatingly simple and deceptively simple. He quotes a bit of Jewish wisdom from the book of Proverbs. Quote, God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. And then he says this, submit to God, resist the devil, draw near to God, and God will draw near to you. That's it. But now you recognize this way of preaching in James, right? Perhaps you, like me, have chafed a bit at it. And yet John Calvin, one sentence after that first sentence in which he says, true and solid wisdom is found in the knowledge of God and of ourselves. One sentence later, he admits, this is not easy to determine. And then he says this, quote, it is perfectly obvious that the endowments which we possess cannot possibly be from ourselves. No, our very being is nothing else than subsistence in God alone. And he goes on from there to write over 1,000 pages, which if I haven't been here that long, but if I may be so bold as to summarize those 1,000 pages, they amount to this: God is God, and we are not. God is God, and we are not. Peel back the rather direct rhetoric of James and the sometimes off-putting tone, and you can hear, can you not, the voice of the Word of God, Jesus himself, calling us to humility and gentleness and forgiveness and patience. And did I mention humility? peace. It can only come for us. It can only come for a world longing to wake up from a bad dream, reaching out for a better way than the way of certitude and violence, holding its breath. It can only come for us when we recognize our complete dependence on the God revealed for us in the One who took up his cross, stretched his arms, and showed us all a different way. If you are like me, Grace Church, well, then you read the news or you get on social media and you come away from it almost paralyzed. There's a lot of information, lots of opinions, lots of jostling for power, very little wisdom. So what do we have to offer? Nothing in ourselves. But we can do what we do every Sunday here, what you do so very well. We can bear witness. We can point away from ourselves to the Prince of Peace. We can take up our own cross and follow him, and with humility and gentleness proclaim a peace that passes all understanding in him. That we can do. So let us. Amen. Let us pray. God of peace, you bring us strength and courage when we are anxious or afraid. You provide wisdom and direction when we face choices and challenges. Thank you for your faithfulness to us. In our prayers, enlarge our love and sharpen our vision so that we may serve the world you love more faithfully. We give you thanks for those who work for peace and mercy in a world divided by bitter conflicts, and for those who keep peace and lead negotiations in international disputes. Give them wisdom and perseverance, We remember those today who face violence, persecution, or discrimination daily. Send your Spirit to protect the vulnerable so that justice and well-being will prevail. We pray for all those facing famine and drought this year, and for those who have lost everything through fire, storm, or conflict. We continue to pray for those in Canada who recover from wildfires. Bring support to those people and agencies who work to alleviate suffering and help them rebuild lives and communities. We pray for teachers and students and educational administrators and support staff this school year. We thank you for the gifts of education, for deepening insight into this ever-changing world, and the ability to inculcate wisdom alongside information. Grant all those in education this year mutual respect and commitment to the shared venture of learning. Give us all a wise and teachable spirit. Then we pray for those struggling with pain or illness, disability, or daunting diagnosis. Stand by their side. Be with those who face death this day and those who weep for loved ones who have died. Hear us now in the silence of our hearts as we lift people and situations close to us. Unite us in love, whatever we are facing, and grant us the peace and hope you have promised us in Christ Jesus, who taught us to pray, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen."
The invitation to share our offerings. The letter of James invites us to show gentleness born of God's wisdom through our good works. The gifts we offer to God support many good works through our congregation and the work Presbyterians undertake together around the world. May they bear fruit, and in Jesus' name, our offerings will now be received. us pray. Wise and faithful God, we offer our gifts to you in thanksgiving for your gifts to us in Christ and in creation. Bless these gifts and the good works they will support, so that the world may know your wisdom and faithfulness through Christ our Lord. Amen. Our concluding hymn is number 712, Arise, Your Light Is Come.
Go now out into the world in peace, and may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord be kind and gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with favor and grant you peace from this day forward and forevermore. Amen.